Hello, my name is Jim Finney, president of Epiphene. Today we're going to talk about new approaches to solids removal and filtration and how we can use that in a modular way to not only ease design but also provide variable flow rates. In my work around the world, including extensive experience in the Middle East and North Africa and India for industrial and HVAC, which included projects like the mosque at Mecca, the Jeddah Airport, Riyadh Airport, Dubai, Doha, Abu Dhabi, Salalah, Muscat, and Cairo. I found that there was a lot lacking in terms of what the market offered and what the cooling towers required. So we're going to cover that here briefly. So in separator technology, separators by and large don't provide 5 micron removal, which is really important when you're looking at PM5s. They don't scale, so you can't get high flow and a high efficiency removal. So that becomes problematic, and especially with the larger cooling systems. They won't handle a wide range of flows, and invasive cooling systems have different needs during the year. The climate changes. And then typically they are high pressure losses, and that costs energy. In the media filter technology, I was appalled when I first entered this industry from another industry. This single tank design that most people look at is the standard is a very poor solution. It's problematic, and it results in most of those systems being abandoned. High water loss, it takes almost as much water to backwash it as it does to filter it in a single tank. You've got no filtration during the backwash. It won't handle a wide range of flows, and typically the pressures required are a lot higher to backwash it. Design limitations, it's an either or. Most companies will offer whatever their main product is, and they can't handle hybrid situations or situations where you need both. Full stream, even though it's discussed and talked about, is very rarely implemented, and normally that's on a industrial project. And so for HVAC, it has been impractical to date. There's no surge capability. I mean, we run in the wintertime, the conditions may be pretty clean in the air quality. And then in the summer or spring or fall, depending on where you are, that may change and you may want to run at a higher rate. And that surge capability allows you to save energy and to address high loading events. So let's look at the comparison between separator technologies. Most effective in removing inorganic materials with solids that have specific gravities greater than 1.2. And in reality, most of the separator companies start at 1.8 specific gravity. The working pressure range in terms of pressure loss is 12 to 20 PSI to get any separation. Whereas our working pressure range loss is 1 to 15 PSI, and we still get efficient separation. Typical removal efficiency is 74 microns and some down to 40 microns. Anything below 40 microns, you need really small separators to make that happen. And typically that's not done in the industry. Typical removal efficiency for the CPH is 5 microns. And we get up to 33% of the half micron. Jar test, that's an industry standard to show what effect the separator would have on a level of solids. And 3 minutes settling time is usually what's used for current offerings. Whereas we use a 24-hour test or 1,440 minutes to show what could be removed. Minimum inlet pressure, 20 PSI for most of those separators. Our minimum input pressure is 10 PSI. So today we're going to look at a technology for separation that does a very good job on removing clay and silt, which heretofore has been pretty much impossible to remove. And the separator itself is very simple. The water comes from the bottom. It's distributed across the plate with 16 radially placed 1-inch hydrocyclones. They separate out the dirt and the clean water comes out the top. So let me explain quickly why our separator works so well and why having 16 separators in a single unit is better than having one large separator. So first, let's talk about quickly, angular velocity is the velocity around this circle, okay? And it's defined by the velocity of the solid moving over the radius, and the radius goes from the center to the outside, okay? So let's look at, here's the radius. Let's think about an ice skater standing right here. And basically, now we've got our arms outstretched, we're in a spin, and I'm moving like this, okay? Now, we thought about that, and you know, typically, as you saw earlier, I used to put small hydrocyclones, but those were about 8 inches in diameter, and we really just couldn't get at that silt. So the idea was, what if we went to smaller separators? Well, it gets impossible to put 1-inch separators out there on a manifold. And so when we thought, well, how do we change the paradigm so that we can get small separators into a single package that will provide us that high level of separation? And so imagine now, if I look at this smaller separator, now I've, just like the proverbial ice skater, now I'm spinning about this point, okay? And the velocity is significantly higher. What does that mean? That means I can remove smaller particles and lighter particles quite efficiently, okay? So that is why we're able to get very, very high separation efficiency of very, very small particles, even at the lower pressures. So let's look at it in this way. Let's replace that arrow with a solids particle. And let's see, here's the velocity going around a larger diameter hydrocyclone or centrifugal separator. And let's do the same thing on ours. Notice the difference in velocity and also the size of the particle. But basically, you're looking at a significantly higher centrifugal action. And that means you're going to be higher efficiency in removal of solids, smaller and lighter. So let's go back to our 16 hydrocyclones radially placed inside a vessel. And let's look at it in terms of our initial model, but all 16 operating at the same time. And you can see now I've got the same surface areas as far as providing water to the system from the outlet of the separator, but I'm performing the separation on far, far smaller diameter hydrocyclones, which leads to far greater efficiencies. So let us look at how we take advantage of this conservation of angular momentum by reducing the radius. We get really high velocities. Let's see really what we can do. So this is the silt that this separator took out. This is the inlet underneath here. You can barely see, it's behind his arm, goes through the separator. This is the purge, and so we'll play this presentation here so you can see how this works. So this is about a 1 psi differential coming out of this purge. This is that inlet coming into the bottom of the separator. You can see there's quite a bit of silt accumulating on the ground. And then as we move up, you'll see that I have clear water coming out. And normally we'd have an automatic purge valve on this, but in this case we wanted to show the comparison between the purge and the outflow. Now he's basically taking this, closing it down, so we've got about a 3 psi differential across the separator. You can see it's still very efficient in removing solids.
Holy moly, look at that.
So those two samples we took, we used those for our comparison between the outlet and the purge, and that's where we got our, actually it was 48 hours, but we used 24 hours to be conservative for our settling test. The size of these particles. So human hair is typically about 50 to 60 microns. If you cut it the same length as the diameter, that would be the size. In this situation, we see beach sand at 90. And usually it's 74 to 90. Silt starts at anything below 74 micron. You can see here we've got salts, we've got a white blood cell. And then if you look at this in terms of what current separators can do, you know, very small separators like 2 or 3 inch inlet might get some 25. Then you look at that compared to where we're operating, and I'll show you here shortly. Not only can we get the larger particles where the current separators do okay, we can get all the way down to a half micron. And the cooling towers, typically, if we can get the 5 micron and above, we've done a very, very good job in terms of dealing with things. And so when you look at the range of what the separator is able to do, far and away exceeds the expectations. Let's quickly look at the solids removal that we tested. All our test media was 80 microns and below. And you can see at 50 microns and above, it's 99%, and sand starts at 74. So this is mostly silt. At 30 microns, we get 99%. At 15, we're getting 94. At 5, we're getting over 66. And even in the clay particles, which are the half micron to 5 micron, we're getting an average of 33%. Let me show you a comparison of how we do a jar test to show whether the separator works in an application, but it's very relevant how our jar test compares to current separators. So typically you'll get an agitated sample in a clear container with a lid. Current separators typically look at 3 minute settling time. You can see there's some sand settled, but a lot of the silt is still suspended. And we wait 24 hours, and everything that settles, and you can see some of these finer layers here, we'll get with our separator in a single pass. So let us quickly look at the modularity that this approach offers. So we typically have a 25 to 125 gallon a minute flow rate recommendation for our separator. We can put two in parallel where the water comes in from either end at the bottom, and then comes out from either end at the top, so we have complete flexibility, and even this can be flipped to our next version, which is taking two of these together, and the water can come in here or in from the other side, and again, this can be flipped. We can also put T's, as we'll see here, and add more of them together. Here is 8 units, so you start to see the real modularity from 2 to 4 to 8, and these are all center fed, so we keep the balanced. And then here's 16, and we go from 400 to 2000 gallons a minute. So let's look at some other options for modularity where we can dramatically increase the flow and scale. So here we have two of those units. It's slightly different configuration. Right now we're going in here, out here, that we can change those directions. So we go in and hit this direction and out that direction. We could also put T or crosses here so that we could actually add multiple units. Here's an example of multiple units with crosses. And this is like 5 meters long and can handle anywhere from 600 to 3000 gallons a minute. So not only did we have requirements where we could go horizontally in our expansion, but we also can go vertically, and we were challenged to provide a very high flow in a 5 meter by 6 meter space. Here's our first option where 1200 to 6000 gallons per minute, and actually each side of here was half of that, so anywhere from 600 to 3000 on each side, fed by a single pump, centrifugal or split case. This is, again, now they ask us to increase the flow rate, so we went up another level, so each one of these can handle 6,000 gallons a minute apiece for a total of 12,000 gallons a minute. So I want to talk briefly about why I believe the current approach to media filtration in HVAC is wrong. First, it was originally envisioned using clean water source to a single filter. Somewhere along the way, somebody decided that they could use the cooling tower water to flush the filter. This, instead of adding an additional tank, as all other industries do, to provide filtered water to flush the filter. So these single tank solutions basically provide no filtration during flushing. They infiltration of the media by contaminants from using dirty water to fluidize the bed is a no-no, and it actually leads to high frequency or continuous flushing, and eventually what happens is that system is abandoned. And because it fails, because it's either got surface sealing issues, contamination of the bed, and the bottom line is that filter gets taken out of service. In addition to what we covered on this single slide about the issue with single filters, the current offerings versus what we're offering also overcome other issues that have yet to be addressed by the industry. And that includes silica oxides, which are susceptible to surface sealing, which leads to high frequency flushing, especially with carbons and bicarbonates. We offer a glass media that's resistant to surface sealing. They often require gravel for an underdrain support and diffusion, not single media, which also contributes to surface sealing because you don't really get 100% cleaning of that surface with a fluidization. We offer a single media solution with our underdrain, which is self-supporting, is also the distribution, which you'll see in a video. And probably the most problematic is the design flow rates are too high for 5 and 10 micron filtration, and nobody in the industry addresses it. You need to have designs that are offered at flow rates commensurate with 5 and 10 micron flux, which is a flow per unit area. And the underdrain designs have dead area, which makes the problem even worse, whereas our underdrain covers almost 100% of the area under the media, and there's no dead areas. And the final thing is we can use better medias because we have 70% less requirement for same. So let's look at some of the advantages small stacked versus large tanks offer. The stackable solution and the cost for the filter pad are easily reduced by up to 50%. Our lower back flush flow reduces the impact on the cooling system. And in fact, those lower flush rates are basically a huge reduction, 12 to 50 gallons a minute, depending on what size we use, and versus 100 to 1,000 gallons a minute, from 24 to 96 inch in diameter. We save a significant amount of water during the flush event. And then we improve the overall system efficiencies because we're able to filter even during high or continuous flush conditions. So even in the middle of a sandstorm where you'd use these, we would be flushing continuously, but you'd still get the majority of the filtration. This also positively impacts your acquisition costs and your operating costs because now we can design in smaller pumps and motors, panels. Our operating costs are going to be lower because we're using less water and less energy to operate the filter. And of course, your life cycle costs for not only the filter, but the entire system improves because we have improved filtration. So in overall, the efficiency of the cooling tower and the cooling system associated with it increases dramatically. So let's look at a recent application where we provided 8 12-inch tanks, 200 gallons a minute, on a 6-foot by 3-foot pad. They wanted 20 micron filtration. And the beauty of this is not only did it take out the silt, but it also was able to backflush with about 12 to 13 gallons a minute in 60 seconds. Typically, a 200-gallon filter would run 200 gallons for the backflush and maybe 3 minutes, maybe 5. So this is a dramatic improvement. So let's look at the backwash, and it shows you a 60-second cycle. You can see the valve is open, and shortly you'll see the solids. And then we'll see that in, and water again. Now, as we mentioned earlier, you can also have this continuously backwashing the other 6 filters are actually providing extra 6.5 for providing filtration to the system even during this backflow. Something you don't get with single tanks. So you can see the backwash water is starting to clear up. The valve will shut shortly. So let's look at our under drain in the back flush mode without media. This is covering almost 100% of the area under the media. It gives us a very fast and turbulent vertical flow to fluidize the bed. And we will guarantee that this high velocity uniform flow will prevent surface sealing, which prevents that continuous or high backwash capability. And there's no other like it in the marketplace. So let's look at the backwash with a media. You can see that we're getting a good surface scouring with our unique inlet and diffuser. And now you can see quite aggressive backwashing. This is 300 or 400%. And we're moving quite a bit of these large particles up higher so that we could get the solids out of the filter. So let's look at the modularity of these. So we can do a simple 2-tank system. We can do a 4-tank system. We can do a 6-tank system, an 8-tank, and then take the 8 tanks and put them in parallel. And so like this particular design, depending on the flux that we are looking for the micron renewal, can go anywhere from 250 to 1600 gallons a minute. This is another one, similar type of situation where we're using those twos to give us, you know, basically 400 to 2400 gallons a minute with 24 tanks. So we can offer skidded systems for media or for separation. Or in some cases, if it's not just separators or not just media filters, but a combination of both needs to be used, we could provide the highest efficiency removal in the industry. What's interesting about the last picture is if you look at these dashed lines, these represent the without a pre-filter from our separator and a solids line with a pre-filter. And you can see that in this case, that basically without a pre-filter, we would have had to flush in 30 minutes. With a pre-filter, we could have gone all the way out to 150 minutes. That's a long time, over 2 hours difference. And actually, this is 5 times longer from here to here for this filter to run. So our systems are scalable to any flow with a separator or with a separator and a media filter. And it's really dependent on what flow rate you need, what solids removal, and if you want to do a variable flow, say during times of low loading versus times of high loading, like during a sandstorm. So you can see here we can get quite large, and these things need to be considered, but the flow rate could be quite large. So in terms of the performance, you know, with our separators, we're looking at half micron removal all the way up to 33% on average. At 5 micron, we're looking at 66. At 15, we're looking at 94. And everything above 30, we're looking at 99 plus. In terms of our performance on our media tanks, in addition to all the advantages, we're able to remove down to 5, 3, or 1 micron, depending on the media and the flow rates. And then our back flush is greatly reduced, which means I can actually perform back washes and filter at the same time. We can meet any conditions, whether you just need solids removal or you just need organic removal or you need both. This would be ideal for cooling tower protection, for heat exchanger protection in place of cartridges, and for sure in dealing with recycled water. We could also treat that water at the ETP plant before it goes to the makeup water. It's modular, so we have lots of design. We can even move parts around to fit an existing space so they don't all have to be on the same skid. And of course, variable speed flows are possible. You know, given the length of this presentation, I will just limit this to, you know, we can deal with high levels of solids by surging. We can deal with low levels of solids by running maybe at a lower flow rate to save energy and water. And we've partnered with WEG for motors and pump controls for VFD to make those things possible, and that's a whole nother presentation. So hopefully today you'll take away that this is definitely a new approach to filtration in the HVAC market. So I'm open for questions.